Urban Dharma is a Buddhist temple and community center in downtown Asheville, open to the public with meditation and teaching space, a Tibetan art slash ritual gallery, and a Buddhist library. Urban Dharma's mission is to foster a deeper understanding of the teachings of the Buddha, to build meaningful community, and to integrate contemplative practices into everyday ordinary life. Urban Dharma hosts both wellness and religious programs. For more information, please visit udharmanc.com or stop by 29 Page Ave across from the Grove Arcade between noon and 5 p.m. every day except Monday. The views expressed on The Final Straw Radio do not necessarily reflect those of Asheville FM, Friends of Community Radio, or any of the affiliate radio stations airing the show. From the studios of Asheville FM, 103.3 FM in Asheville, North Carolina, this is The Final Straw, and I'm William Goodenough. The show will later be archived at thefinalstrawradio.noblogs.org, and you can email us with questions or suggestions at thefinalstrawradio@riseup.net. Also, if you're interested in rebroadcasting any episode or segment of the show, you're free to do so. Just send us an email so we can say hello about it. If you care to, you can send us letters at The Final Straw, care of Asheville FM, 864 Haywood Road, Asheville, North Carolina, 28806. The show is brought to you by Firestorm Books and Coffee. Located at 610 Haywood Road, Firestorm Books and Coffee is a worker-owned cooperative in Asheville specializing in offbeat, underground, and independent literature. You can find a sample of Firestorm's catalog of books and zines, plus a full calendar of events at their website, firestorm.coop.
This week, I spoke with Karen, a member of the Incarcerated Workers Organizing Committee in Gainesville, Florida. People imprisoned across the state of Florida are gearing up for a work strike and a boycott of prison profit centers such as commissary beginning on January 15th, and the Gainesville IWOC chapter has been a crucial node of support on the outside for this action. I spoke with Karen to get the scoop on what to expect from the upcoming strike, the demands of folks who are participating, the broader context of the movement to end prison slavery, and how folks inside and outside are organizing to counter brutal conditions in Florida prisons and beyond.
But first, here is an announcement regarding the very first anniversary of January 20th, 2017, upon which day over 200 people were kettled and arrested on L and 12th Streets by D.C. police for allegedly protesting the inauguration of Donald Trump. This case has become a rallying example of the United States' eagerness to punish even a glimmer of dissent against the established regime. The first six of the initial defendants have just been acquitted of all charges, charges which would have amounted to many decades behind bars had they gone through. But there are still over 180 defendants awaiting trial, and there is a long road ahead in terms of support and resistance. From crimethink.com, quote, "We propose to use the week of J20 2018 to reconnect with our networks, revitalize our spaces, organize new projects, hold special events, and bring people together to build our movements. Autonomous spaces include info shops, community centers, and bookstores. But an autonomous space can also be a public place you make a habit of gathering in, or a territory you share and defend. Open spaces offer a way for people who are freshly curious about our movements to plug in, pick up literature, and begin fostering relationships. Towards this end, we are encouraging people to organize on the week of J20. Community events involving putting in work at autonomous spaces. This could mean fixing the bathroom or repainting the walls, or it could mean soliciting people to bring supplies, books, and other materials to add to the space. Let this be an opportunity for the community surrounding the space to strengthen and expand the physical infrastructure. Block parties and celebrations around the space, reconnecting the wider community that uses and interacts with it and bringing in new people. Fundraising events to support the space. This could include speaking events, film showings, and more." End quote. To that end, right here in Asheville, we're kicking off a week of rebellious activities with a Haywood Road block party to share food, fun, and knowledge. This is a free event open to everyone, so bring your friends and let's talk about where we want to go from here. Schedule of events is as follows. From 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. on the 20th, workshops including Uprooting White Supremacy in Appalachia, an interactive presentation by the Holler Network at Firestorm. 6 to 7 p.m., a community vegetarian potluck at Firestorm. 7 to 9 p.m., workshops including a presentation by the Callisto Collective at Firestorm. 9 p.m. till whenever, a DJ dance party at local 604 Bottle Shop right next door to Firestorm. And throughout the week, on Sunday, January 21st, a documentary film night at Static Age Records. The 23rd, we'll see a karaoke fundraiser at the Lazy Diamond. 26th, we'll see a trouble screening at Firestorm. A list of local participating groups is as follows. The Asheville Industrial Workers of the World, Asheville Prison Books, Blue Ridge Anarchist Black Cross, Callisto Collective, Firestorm Books and Coffee, the Holler Network, and the J20 Defendants. To see a full Facebook event, you can get on that machine and search Build the Base 2018. And for the initial call from CrimeThink, you can go to crimethink.com and search Build the Base, Take the Initiative.
NATO 3 prisoner J. Jared Chase is currently being held in segregation and is in some need of some books. The NATO 3 was a terrorism case stemming from the protests around the NATO summit that was to take place in Chicago in May of 2012. Out of it, three people, Brian Jacob Church, Brent Betterly, and Jared J. Chase, were threatened with terrorism enhancements. Those were dropped, but they were convicted of incendiary possession and mob action. Jay is the only member of the three still in prison, having received additional sentencing and the loss of one full year of good behavior due to a retaliatory assault on an officer. During Jay's time inside, his supporters have become aware that he is experiencing the onset of Huntington's disease, an inherited disorder whose earliest symptoms are often subtle problems with mood or mental abilities. Jay was recently moved from Pontiac to Dixon Prison and has been in segregation for a bit. Please send him books if you can. Prisoners in Illinois can receive used books in the mail, and Jay also has an Amazon wish list at amazon.com/GP. Jay likes to read sci-fi, fantasy fiction, and history. Segregation is a very tough time on anyone as you are confined to your cell at least 23 hours a day. Please show Jay some solidarity and support through this time. Jared Chase, M44710, Dixon Correctional Center, 2600 North Brinton Avenue, Dixon, Illinois, 61021. And more information about the case can be found at freethenato3.wordpress.com.
But first, here are some words from anarchist prisoner San Swain.
What you say, what you say, what you say, what?
After the not guilty verdicts in the Chicago conspiracy trial in 1969, one of the jurors was interviewed. An older white woman who admitted she voted for Nixon. Explaining her not guilty verdict, she said simply that this was the first time she was afraid of her government. In that bellwether case for the Nixon fascist regime, so-called leaders of the protest outside the Democratic National Convention were put on trial for conspiracy, facing the rest of their lives in prison. Defendants included Abby Hoffman and Jerry Rubin of the Yippies, Bobby Seale of the Black Panthers, and anti-war pacifists. The fascist intent was for those trials and their anticipated outcome to spread a climate of fear to silence protest. The current sociopath in the White House makes Nixon look like Bernie Sanders, and it's no coincidence that from its inception, the Trump machine has pushed an ambitious and oppressive agenda against free speech and political dissent. On the day that this sociopath was sworn in, his Nazis arrested 230 protesters in Washington, D.C., intending to make D.C. stand for dissent control, charging protesters with felony conspiracy to riot. On Inauguration Day, hundreds marched, peacefully, unfortunately, through D.C., until they reached the corner of L and 12th Street, where the fascists had set up a blockade. Fascists then followed the marchers in, creating what's called a kettle. Hundreds, including journalists and legal observers, were essentially held hostage. The kettle lasted over 8 hours as folks had to go without food, water, medical help, or even toilets. People were forced to urinate in water bottles. A group of about 100 managed to break out of the blockade and escape. All 230 who remained were arrested, held for 36 hours because of a handful of actions by a handful of people. By the official statistics, 6 windows were broken and 6 cops were injured. Even journalists were charged, though some charges were later dropped. Just an observation here, but if 6 cops were injured, that means hundreds were not. By my thinking, those fascist bastards shouldn't be arresting protesters. They should be buying them dinner and gift cards and thanking the protesters for sparing their worthless pig lives. But what do I know? The media has portrayed that the hundreds of kettled hostages were also responsible for burning a limousine, but that's simply not true. The limo was burned hours after the kettle began, blocks away. Over 200 people faced 70 years in prison apiece on conspiracy charges for a few isolated incidents in a large crowd. So the real aim of the fascist regime in prosecuting them is to essentially criminalize being in close proximity to those who commit a potentially criminal act. The aim is to spread a climate of fear that prevents others from ever protesting or dissenting, for fear of criminal charges for everyone, if even one person smashes a window that perhaps has it coming. In this case, there's the threat of something like a total of 16,000 years in prison for 12 alleged criminal acts, 6 broken windows and 6 injured cops. That comes out to more than 1,300 years for each of the 12 acts, distributed among more than 200 people, who just happened to be close by. This is almost comparable to the historic Chicago conspiracy trial. Except in the current witch hunt, the fascists haven't just charged the so-called leaders, but have charged everyone present. This would be comparable if the thousands of college kids who attended the 1968 DNC protests had all been charged and tried for conspiracy charges. The current fascist regime's prosecution strategy is to try a handful of protesters at a time in groups of 6 to 8. The idea is for them to use trial after trial to accumulate information they can use in the next trial and the next, a process of evolving evidence. One protester, Dane Powell, took a non-cooperating plea back in April and served a 4-month prison term. Dane is an Army vet who saw a young woman holding her infant son blinded by the chemical weapons deployed by the fascists who had kettled everyone. Dane carried the child and led the young woman to safety. Police claim Dane also found the time to throw bricks and assault cops. Why they gave him prison time rather than making a comic book about this guy, I'll never know. Since then, in early December, lawyers filed motions to dismiss charges because the lead detective in the case, Gregory Pemberton, lied to the grand jury. Pemberton, by the way, is also the treasurer for the Fraternal Order of Police for D.C., which means he's probably bonded, and his home address, then, is public information somewhere. Not suggesting that anyone should post that online or anything. Not suggesting that at all. After this lead detective got caught lying and fabricating a case, the first group of defendants went on trial. On December 21st, they were all found not guilty on all charges. Not guilty. Now, consider, in the American injustice system, a fraction of 1% of criminal defendants get found not guilty. So in a normal situation, those defendants in the first round of conspiracy trials would likely represent not guilty verdicts for an entire year nationwide. Not trying to be too optimistic here, but I think this might just signal that the fascist criminalization of free speech agenda might just be unraveling. All the more reason for us to do everything we can to support the remaining criminal defendants and to expose this corrupt regime's true repressive aims. This is one of those rare defensive struggles that needs and deserves our collective commitment. Because, in the final analysis, our own future action needs all of those charged protesters to go free. This is one of those battles that will stand out when our kids or grandkids look back from a world strewn with smoldering cop cars and Walmarts, and see these trials as the moment when resistance galvanized against tyranny. We're walking on pure history and we know it. Now, let's show these f***ing fascists what real solidarity looks like. This is anarchist prisoner Sean Swain from War and Corruption in Lebanon, Ohio. If you're standing with the J20 rebels, you are the resistance.
You can write to Sean Swain at seanswain243-205, Warren CI, P.O. Box 120, 5787 State Route 63, Lebanon, Ohio, 45036. Updates on his situation and more writings by Sean can be found at seanswain.org.
I'm Disembodied Voice, and I'm here speaking with Karen from the Gainesville IWOC. That's the Incarcerated Workers Organizing Committee, chapter out of Gainesville, Florida. And Karen, it's so great to have you on The Final Straw to hear a little bit about what's going on in Gainesville and Florida for the upcoming work stoppage in Florida state prisons. So thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me. I'm really excited about getting the word out.
And so I already mentioned that you're part of the Gainesville IWOC. Could you maybe start just by introducing yourself and talking about the work you do with IWOC?
Sure. So for those who don't know, IWOC is the Incarcerated Workers Organizing Committee of the Industrial Workers of the World Union. Basically, I work alongside fellow workers who are imprisoned to abolish prison slavery. You know, what that looks like is building membership in the union, creating and distributing prisoner written materials for organizing purposes. We work to build support outside and inside as far as building solidarity on the outside for actions that are going on the inside. We put together educational events, fundraising events. We act as a media liaison. So we basically organize with prisoners to help facilitate their campaigns with the resources that we have access to out here.
And how long have you been doing this work with IWOC?
Okay, so I've only been with IWOC since the beginning of the summer this year. I have done prison activism for quite a while. And here in Florida, the work I was doing just kind of started to look like what IWOC was doing, which has only been around since 2014, IWOC. So it's a relatively new endeavor. I met up with some IWOCers at different conferences, and you know, the things we were talking about, the things we were doing were very similar. So at the beginning of the summer, I decided to sign on with the union and work through that vehicle for support nationwide campaigns, which is what IWOC does.
Sure. And it definitely seems like since it did emerge in 2014, IWOC has been pretty active and pretty central in a lot of support actions coming out of prisons.
Yeah, it's a really impressive organization, what they've been able to accomplish in just a few years. And it's prisoner-led movement, which is something that's been missing in prison activism.
Right. And I'm not sure if you mentioned this, but I think it's important to mention that IWOC doesn't just support folks who are incarcerated in their labor organizing goals, but is actually actively like integrating incarcerated workers into the union. I think you mentioned that, but maybe just to highlight it, that this is actually the only union in the country that actually includes people who are incarcerated as workers in a union.
Right. It's the only union that recognizes prison labor as actual work. And when I say building membership, that's exactly what it is. Membership on the inside.
Great. Okay, so just to kind of get to the primary purpose of this interview, we would love to hear more about what's going to be happening starting on January 15th in Florida prisons.
Okay, so on the 15th, prisoners across the state plan on engaging in a nonviolent work stoppage and a boycott of all profitable services. This is in protest of prison slavery and conditions in general in Florida prisons. So what that means is everybody that participates will have a lay down, they've been calling it, just not going to work, not going to chow, not participating in any, state sanctioned activities, not shopping at the commissary, not making phone calls, and not going to visits. Although the way the Florida Department of Corrections responds to such actions is they cancel visits anyway. So that one will probably be imposed, not so much an option. But basically not spending any money on any of the services that prison profiteers benefit from and not participating in the running of the prisons.
Yeah, I hadn't realized from the initial call out that folks also like wouldn't be going to chow or taking visits. That's even beyond what I had realized.
Well, yeah, part of that is that they won't be working in the kitchens and creating the chow. So there will be no chow to go to.
That's an important point. I think that gets underspoken about is that it's really the folks who are incarcerated that run the prison and actually make it possible for it to function. I think a lot of folks, when they think about prison labor, they think about like private industry exploiting folks' work, and that absolutely happens. But because of the disproportionate focus in the media on private prisons, people think that it's primarily privatized industry where the prison labor goes to, and they don't realize that it's actually to make the prison itself function.
Sure, right. And also, you know, when we talk about prison slavery, our brains go to like chattel slavery and road crews and, you know, chain gangs. And all. It's important to remember that just being a body in a prison is profitable to someone. Even if you don't have a work assignment or an actual paid prison contract labor assignment, just being there, somebody is profiting from you. So there's a lot of layers to this slavery.
And so your reference to prison slavery, I think, is for many people going to be familiar, but especially for folks who haven't necessarily been aware of or tracking where the movement has been in the last few years, would you be able to talk about Operation Push, which is the name that has been given to this upcoming labor laydown? Would you be able to talk about kind of how Operation Push is a continuation of a number of recent actions over the last couple years addressing the issue of prison slavery?
Yeah. As far as Operation Push is concerned, Florida has been kind of disconnected a little bit from the national movement. We haven't had any sophisticated inside campaigns with loud voices that are getting published, in periodicals and newspapers. So it kind of just sprang up alongside the September 9th, 2016. So with zero organizing on the outside in Florida, Florida prisoners kicked off the 9-9 work strike on the 7th, and they went all in. So as far as fitting into the bigger context, I think this is a nationwide movement that had no choice but to grow. It is not going away because the conditions are only worsening. And whether it is organized and sophisticated or if it is stuff just popping up here and there, I think it's inevitable. And it ties into the larger movement in that prisoners are seeing examples of what can be done, of what organizing, how effective organizing can be. They're seeing the whole Trump presidency. They're seeing an increase in, you know, the private aspect of prison profiteering and this willingness to kind of trade our communities over to these industries. And people in and out have been pushed to a point where it's inevitable, you know, like these revolutions are inevitable. So in the larger context, we've seen some really amazing campaigns and movements grow out of like the Free Alabama movement, the Free Ohio movement, Jailhouse Lawyers Speak. We've seen it coordinated with national movements on the outside, like the Millions for Prisoners March in DC. And we see isolated protests just popping off all over the place because there is momentum behind this because of the organizing and just because of the deplorable conditions.
Yeah, and I know you said that you feel that Florida has been kind of disconnected, but it does seem like folks in Florida have been involved. Like you mentioned in the August action last year, they went on like preemptive lockdown, right? Because they thought people were going to participate in that call to action.
Right. Well, yeah, it is last year now, isn't it?
Okay. Yeah.
It is. Yeah. So for the 2016 thing, for the Attica anniversary, September 9th, 2016, that was really unexpected, the level of involvement that Florida prisoners took on.
And can you just explain what that is, just for folks who may not be aware?
Sure. The Attica prison uprisings, 1971 in New York, prisoners went on strike and kind of stopped participating. And, you know, it was dubbed a riot and it was bloody and violent and people died. But the prisoners gained control of the prison. And during that period of time, they organized amongst themselves on the yard, and there were no injuries. There was no violence. And it stands as an example of, you know, prison rebellion and harnessing that collective power that you have as a prisoner. So on the anniversary, 3 years prior, like I said, in 2014, IWOC became a thing in response to this prisoner organizing that was going on in preparation for the Attica anniversary. There was a nationwide work strike planned that took 3 years, you know, to plan amongst these various prisoner movements on the inside and support networks on the outside. In preparation for that, we here in Gainesville, I hadn't joined IWOC then, but I was working with a campaign to fight toxic prisons. We sent out a quick newsletter to Florida prisoners to say, hey, this is a thing that's going on nationally. And I mean, it was only a week prior to the scheduled strike, and the newsletters made it in around the 1st, and on the 7th, Florida prisoners just, you know, popped off at Holmes Correctional and a few other facilities, like where we were able to see pictures and there was actual coverage. So since then is when we really tapped in and began organizing with through IWOC. And so that was almost a year later, when August 19th, we were able to pretty significant ground in Florida prisons. We have a established contact list. We have a rather large mailing list of over 700 prisoners in the state who we organize with and share literature with. And the Florida Department of Corrections just, you know, preemptively decided to put the entire state on lockdown on the Wednesday before the Millions for Prisoners March, and before we had an event, a demonstration organized outside of Franklin Correctional up in the Panhandle here in Florida. So they went, for the first time ever, they went on statewide lockdown indefinitely. It lasted for 5 days, but when they made that decision, they had no end in sight for the lockdown, which is, you know, historical. At the moment, with our campaign for Operation Push, we have a really generous lawyer working with us who has done public records requests for every conversation and document surrounding the decision to go on lockdown for August 19th last year. So what we're kind of, one of our strategies with Operation Push is to kind of get in front of it with the DOC and ask them if they are going to respond to prisoners engaged in nonviolent protest of their deplorable conditions with further repression and violence, or if they're willing to come to the table and have a discussion about addressing these issues. This time around, we've had a lot more opportunity to contribute to the narrative instead of just violent criminals rioting because they're bad people and they're violent and it's what they do. You know, we've been able to kind of get in front of it this time. And I think it's a different situation for the Department of Corrections that they're going to have to respond to, because they cannot claim that it was just a reaction to a riot. You know, this is premeditated state oppression. So even having that conversation with them in the open and in the newspapers is just such a advantage, I think, for the movement that we didn't have last time around.
That's really great to hear, because I was feeling that this action seems to kind of be the culmination or the next logical step that really kind of like leverages a lot of learnings that have come out of so many of these recent actions. So it's the idea that you guys are like getting in front of this is great to hear. And I was going to ask, in addition to the kind of preemptive lockdown, are there other types of repression that we can kind of credibly anticipate seeing coming down? Because, you know, this is a pretty the call to action that came out of the prisons was to do the work stoppage for, if I'm not wrong, up to a month, which is a very long time to sustain that kind of action. And so I can only assume that the repression will be intense and building over time. So is there, you've already spoken about the lockdown. Are there any other types of repression that we can anticipate, and specifically that folks on the outside who want to be supportive can kind of prepare to respond to or support around?
Yeah. You know, so as far as the retaliation goes, it will be controlled movement. It will be no, I mean, I don't want to say it will be. Who knows? Maybe the Department of Corrections will take a whole different approach. But if they do go into a lockdown, there will be no visits. There will be no phone calls. So communication is immediately dampened. There will also be, in the past, they haven't retaliated really violently with chemical agents, you know, physical abuse. So what that looks like is they will generally come in, break up a dorm with chemical agents and, you know, nightsticks or whatever they're using, batons. And they will separate the people who are actively resisting or are participating in the strike, because it is obvious at this point. They have broken them up, put them in vans, and sent them out to different camps. At those camps, they end up in solitary confinement, where a lot of the people who were more, some of the louder voices or the more involved protesters last year, they are just now getting out of solitary confinement. You know, they're 9-10 months sentenced to solitary. So that's one of the ways that they're going to retaliate. Something else they've been doing is ramping up their use of, it's a CM, which is closed management is what they call it now. It's actually changed over the years, but what that is, it's a status within the Florida Department of Corrections. Once you achieve CM status, you basically will spend the rest of your time in a solitary type environment where you might have one roommate, but you're on in a closed solitary wing where you get your 1 hour a day in a small yard or a different cage, and meals are brought to you. And your communication and what you can and can't receive are severely limited. So that's something they've been using. And I know that's something that has been used throughout, you know, history with our American prison system, but something that they're really making use of right now in Florida. One of our fellow workers inside IWOC members, Kevin Rashid Johnson, is in Florida, and he is permanently on CM status. So I cannot even send a letter to him. He is not even allowed to receive mail unless it's from a media outlet or his lawyer. So as far as organizing around those retaliations and ways to support, I mean, the most basic and obvious one is just keeping lines of communication open with letters, information, updates, sending in stamps, especially if they cannot purchase things from the commissary, sending stamps, envelopes, paper. Of course, that stuff has to make it through a mailroom, and generally the mailroom will just throw it away or, you know, keep it. Especially in situations like this where they're trying, you know, where they're upping repression. Call-in campaigns have been extremely helpful in Florida, especially with these the people who are targeted and put in solitary and long-term CM status or a long-term solitary bid. We have just kind of pinpointed certain links in the administrative chain that are susceptible to pressure more than others for whatever reason. And the Inspector General office is something we've made a lot of use of, you know, starting a complaint through the Inspector General's office and then following up with it at the state and the institution and the regional level. So calling campaigns are something that's great to put pressure on the DOC. And I'd like to see it extended, which something that we haven't really done is to representatives here in Florida. To put pressure on them to have a voice in this and to, you know, affect the DOC's behavior.
Yeah, that's great. Calling campaigns are always always good to be able to jump onto, which, by the way, if people want to do that, is there like a mailing list or something or a website to check for those calls?
Yeah, on our national IWOC website, all of that information is available. When we start a new call-in campaign, it's listed there. There's a script. There is a follow-up section where you can put a little note, you know, that you called and what happened so we can track it. Also on our social media pages for Gainesville IWOC, Campaign to Fight Toxic Prisons, and SPARC, which is Supporting Prisoners and Real Change. We will, if any call-in campaigns or letter writing or pressure campaigns of any sort, whether it be an outside demo, will be available there.
Great.
Can give you all that stuff.
And I did want to ask about Fight Toxic Prisons and SPARC, because I know that the initial call out from inside the prisons for this action was kind of disseminated through those three channels, mainly was Fight Toxic Prisons, SPARC, and IWOC. I'm curious about the relationship, if any, between y'all as organizations and how you are kind of like collaborating on supporting this action, or how you will be.
Yeah, here in Gainesville, we campaign to fight toxic prisons and IWOC work very closely together. We all work out of the same space. Our work is very similar. We support each other's campaigns. We are almost one in the same for Florida work. Outside of what we're doing here, the campaign to fight toxic prisons organizes against the prison system on an environmental tip. So it's the intersection of prison and the environment, and how prison causes environmental degradation, not just to our physical environment, but our social environment, our emotional environment, our financial environment. So campaign to fight toxic prisons, that work looks a lot like getting prisons shut down and preventing them from being built, exposing toxic situations, which prisons tend to be in. You know, they're put in places that have already been used up that nobody wants, such as old military bases, mine sites, landfills. The event that we're holding locally in support of Operation Push on the 15th will be outside of Florida Department of Corrections Reception and Medical Center, which is in Lake Butler, Florida, just about 20 miles north of Gainesville. And that prison has a massive landfill on one side of it and a proposed phosphate mine site on the other. And I mean, it is a prison that houses 1,500 people, like most Florida prisons, but it's also a medical center where the prisoners already have vulnerable health conditions. And a phosphate mine, if you don't know, poisons the land, the water, the air, also tons of noise pollution. And it is, from what we've seen in Florida before, phosphate mines, they contaminate the water supply, the aquifer, they've dried up the springs as the water is pulled out. The toxic water, which Florida prisons have in and of themselves. I mean, that's one of the biggest complaints we hear is contaminated water, discolored water, a mold throughout the institutions, the incredible temperatures that prisoners have to deal with. There's no air conditioning in Florida prisons, you know? So Campaign to Fight Toxic Prisons organizes around prison as an environmental issue. The other group, SPARC, that is the brainchild of Kevin Rashid Johnson, something that we have been wanting to help him put together. It's kind of been in the background until Operation Push came out. We had started SPARC, but we hadn't really used it, you know, and it was gaining little traction. It was fresh, brand new, just a couple months old when we got the Operation Push message. So it seemed like a good time to kind of really throw our energy into it and launch it. It is just a social media page for Florida prisoners and their families and any community members that care to get involved and organize, you know, around these issues. And it's been instrumental. I mean, our following has grown, and we have gotten a lot of good contacts and, you know, offers of support through that page.
And so is it kind of accurate to say that SPARC is not necessarily coming from any kind of ideological position or political position, but just kind of a pure social solidarity kind of orientation?
Yeah, exactly. You know, the IWOC work, the FTP work, we have like specific support bases and people who, you know, respond well to those agendas and want to organize those levels. And then SPARC is really just, it's what people will make of it. You know, it's what the prisoners and their families and friends will make of it. So yeah, there is no, there's no agenda that, that must be subscribed to, or there's no, I mean, the direction is to abolish prisons, you know, I mean, as far as maintaining that site and shaping the stories and the information that are on it, you know, it will be as a vehicle for prison, you know, abolition. So if it was to take some direction where it was like some sort of, you know, anything derogatory or discriminatory, or, you know, oftentimes prison guards like to get on our pages and kind of direct the conversation. So that's something that It's for Florida prisoners and their families to organize in a way they see fit. But also, I mean, there are limits to, you know, the message that
they'll support
will come out of it.
Sure. I think it's cool to have a number of different channels and have a different various groups supporting and showing up in the ways that they want to and feel is right for them. I think it's really cool that all these groups are working together to support this really important action.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's like Christians out there and stuff that want to get involved, and my circles don't cross their circles generally. So, you know,
hey, if there's a good reason for us all to get together, abolishing prisons has got to be it.
Absolutely. I mean, it affects everybody. It affects absolutely everybody. So.
And you mentioned some of the conditions in Florida prisons, just the amount of use of force and the retaliation. It seems important to kind of put a focus for a minute on the conditions in Florida prisons, because not to kind of compare oppressions, all prisons are awful and the conditions in all prisons are awful. That being said, from all the evidence that we can acquire, it definitely appears like something is going on in Florida prisons that's making the conditions even more intolerable. And there are a number of different aspects to it. There have been high profile, like gratuitous murders of people in Texas, too. Yeah. In Florida prisons. I was wondering if you could maybe just like speak to specifically the conditions in Florida that are really core to what folks are dealing with.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good old boy network. I mean, we literally, at the prison that we're going to be outside of on the 15th, they recently exposed a KKK plot to kill Black inmates once they're released.
Wow.
I mean, I think that says it all. It's crazy what's going on down here. They're, I mean, boiling people to death in a shower, people with mental illness. The Miami Herald has done some incredible reporting over the past few years on conditions in Florida prisons. It's beyond belief. You know, it's beyond just inadequate food portions, which is a real thing in Florida prisons. You are not fed enough food to survive on. People depend on their families and, you know, commissary in order to get a full caloric day in. The conditions that are really pushing people, I think, to their limit, I think it really does come down to, like, the brutality by the guards. I mean, I get letters on the daily of guards, you know, you're walking in line, which already they've started new rules where there's no speaking allowed while moving. So if you're going from your dorm to chow, you're not allowed to make a noise. And if you do that, that is provocation, inciting a riot. So here's one story that I just got this week. A boy, he's 21. He's been in prison for 3 years already. He's a Black boy. He's walking in line. For no reason at all, a guard kicks him in the back of the knee to like push his leg out, you know, so he like, you know, falters a minute, almost falls down, and then sprays him in the back of the head with chemical agents. And then when he makes a noise, he's like, "You talking, boy?" Pushes him out of line, takes him around the corner, and proceeds to beat him while telling him, "I got something for you." You know, this is the normal daily practice in Florida prisons. It's atrocious. Your food is rotten and spoiled and inadequately sized. It's coming on a tray that has mold throughout it, throughout the cracks. There's no dishwashers. You know, some institutions might here and there have a dishwasher. Most do not any longer. If they do, it's been long time broken. They're basically trying to squeeze profits out of a rock with, and I don't want to say understaffing is a problem, because I don't think we need more prison guards. I think we need less prisoners, but nobody wants to work in them. You know, it's just as dangerous to walk in the front door as it is to get brought in shackles through the back.
Yeah. And I mean, I agree that with what you said about not more guards, less incarcerated people, but this issue of understaffing has actually come up in various articles in the Miami Herald, and actually even one that just came out by Kevin Rashid Johnson, who you mentioned earlier. The issue of understaffing actually does seem to be exacerbating some of these conditions. I was wondering if you could maybe speak about that.
Yeah, so, you know, these are in rural areas where it's already hard to, there's not a huge hiring pool. And people have already been through that option. A lot of people, you know, the turnover rate is really high in Florida prisons. It doesn't offer the long-term economic stability that it once purported to, you know, it not for the community or the individual. They're making 15 bucks an hour if they're lucky, and they're in extremely dangerous settings. Basically, it's just a powder keg,
right,
with a million factors leading towards this is not going away.
Yeah. And I mean, I asked that question definitely not to say like what we need is better, more guards and better trained guards, but just honestly to address the fact that like when there is high turnover, when there is a lack of training, like people are more at risk. You know, like you said, it's a powder keg, and it does seem like that high turnover and the frustration and the grind, does contribute directly to incarcerated people being brutalized and victimized. So it seems important from that level.
Yeah, and also, you know, the guards aren't making any money and they're working long hours. So they're supplementing their income in so many ways that it's just such opportunity to make money through the inmates, you know, whether it be bringing in cell phones, drugs, whatever. You know, they are the conduits for the contraband, you know, for the most part. Right. So that adds another layer of like internal conflict between administration and their guards that has been really, I think, picking up a lot of their resources and time lately as well. So it's not working on any level in any way. It's certainly not making any communities safer, anybody's lives safer, and it's extremely expensive and, you know, ineffective. So I feel like add in the deplorable conditions and the frustration and tension on the prisoner's part, and it is, you know, it's coming to a head. And like I said, getting in front of it with the Department of Corrections, giving them an ample opportunity to devise a reaction that is not at the end of a billy club, you know, I think is kind of crucial and something that's just a little bit different this time around.
And in terms of what the goals of the strike are, one is, of course, abolish prison slavery, have people be compensated for their labor. Another is end the exorbitant pricing in the commissary, the items that folks can buy from the prison, which are like on average like twice that of any other state system's commissary, even, which they're all inflated. And then the final one being restore full like access to parole, even for folks who have life sentences and long sentences. The strategy of the action is, the call out says, you know, to bring the state system to its knees, basically, that by doing the math, we can see that the system simply can't continue if folks refuse to do the labor that keeps it going. Other than just running the actual facilities themselves, which we've talked about, are there particular companies or prison industries that are profiting that are going to be specifically hit hard by this?
Well, right off the bat, the Securus industry that handles all the phone calls, and the Keefe who handles the commissary. Yeah, that is where it'll be felt first. I think other boycotts are important on the outside for companies that benefit from prison contracting. So that would be, you know, us on the outside, some of our focus. But here in Florida, we use prison contracting happens through PRIDE. I can't even remember what that acronym spells out, but it's basically convict leasing. Our bigger industries in Florida are for license plates, office furniture, uniforms, things for the state. Our prison workers generally create things for the state here in Florida.
And that is very common.
Yeah, right. So it is a company, you know, that profits, but it is owned by the state, which is just really illustrates that whole, you know, 13th Amendment jump from individuals in industry benefiting from slave labor to the state directly profiting from slave labor is what, you know, was accomplished with that amendment. And something that has risen up to the surface, and I'm hearing a lot about from Florida prisoners since this Operation Push developed, was Florida has decided to ban MP3 players, which is how Florida prisoners listen to their music and have for, I don't know, 10 years at least. So they're replacing it with tablets. And if you have an MP3 player, you can trade it in for a credit against the tablet. And the tablet will be actually pretty affordable. If you don't, they're about $80. But what's really got prisoners pissed off is all the music that they have paid for on their MP3 players, in some cases, hundreds of dollars. The state is only offering a $10 credit towards new music for their tablets. So they are literally going to lose, combined tons of money. And they're really, really upset about that. That's an issue that might be more unifying than any other issue with this strike. So that's to the top of the demand list. And then some other issues, this whole phosphate mine being built, that's something that we've been talking to prisoners about and asking them to, you know, have a voice on and to organize around. As far as their demands go, they are really adamant that we mention the MP3 situation because it's got a lot of people upset.
What support are people asking for on the outside?
Mostly to have this message pushed around right now, you know, to get it out there, to be talking about it, to be posting it, sharing it, organizing solidarity events. I mean, in Florida, we have 145, I think, correctional facilities, prisons, 145 of them. We have organized events outside a few as of right now, Everglades CI down south, Reception and Medical Center in Lake Butler, and something at Gulf CI up in the Panhandle is in the works. I would really like to impress upon people to just start one, to just organize a solidarity action outside of the prison that's closest to you. I mean, even if it's just a handful of people for an hour, it is so meaningful. A common message, a common theme in this whole movement that I keep hearing over and over from prisoners is when they know people on the outside are just there, it drives the movement on the inside. And when they're not there, the movement dies. So letters, you know, we will be putting up, the organizers have remained extremely anonymous. We don't want the Department of Corrections to be able to pinpoint any one spot in their vast prison state where to apply pressure. So once the strike is underway, I think it'll be a lot easier to support people because we will be able to stop the anonymity to a certain degree, be able to put up lists of names that people can write and send, you know, books and literatures and zines. As far as commissary goes, we are fundraising. We have a You Caring fundraiser going, which we have used to put out mass mailings. In addition, IWOC has generously donated a bunch of money to help with them. We mailed out just last Friday 1,100 zines to Florida prisoners with Operation Push outlined in it, amongst other revolutionary writings and strategies for 2018 and resources and contact lists. So if you just keep an eye on our pages, keep an eye on IWOC for call-in campaigns, keep an eye on Campaign to Fight Toxic Prisons and Gainesville IWOC and SPARC Facebook pages for events and for lists of prisoners that will need support, especially the ones that get locked up in confinement for this. We will be doing everything we can to support them while there and to try to get them out, which is where the call-in campaigns come in. I'd just like to see people get out there and make some noise.
Thank you for listening to Disembodied Voices interview with Karen of the Incarcerated Workers Organizing Committee in Gainesville, Florida. To see their You Caring site, you can go to youcaring.com/operationpush-1051439. To see more about the Gainesville IWOC, you can go to incarceratedworkers.org/branches/Gainesville. And to see more about Fight Toxic Prisons, you can go to fighttoxicprisons.wordpress.com. And that's it. Thanks for listening. The show is brought to you by Firestorm Books and Coffee. Located at 610 Haywood Road, Firestorm Books and Coffee is a worker-owned cooperative in Asheville specializing in offbeat, underground, and independent literature. You can find a sample of Firestorm's catalog of books and zines, plus a full calendar of events at their website, firestorm.coop. Police at the ease in the street.
Nation with their guns and ammunition. Police.